Representative Tucker, members of the Environment and Natural Resources Committee. I'm Browning Carson, State Senator from District 24, live in Harpswell, and also represent Brunswick, Freeport, North Yarmouth, and Pownal. I'm pleased to present LD 820, an act to protect Maine's clean water and taxpayers from mining pollution. Over the past 5 years, many people have asked for the strong protections in this bill in their comments on the iterations of the mining rules and other proposed statutes that have come to this committee, some of which are back again this year. LD 820 contains a ban on mines in, on, or under public lands and bans ore removal, ore processing, and mining waste disposal in floodplains. LD 820 also makes the definition of mining area, in quotes, much more protective by limiting it to areas of ore removal. Thus, LD 820 would prohibit groundwater contamination from processing facilities, reservoir, disposal areas, waste rock pile. The 2012 law allows contamination from these areas. In addition, LD 820 would require DEP to develop rules to strictly limit groundwater pollution in areas of ore removal rather than allowing unlimited pollution in mining areas as the 2012 law does. And groundwater contamination cannot migrate from these sites. DEP needs to limit groundwater pollution from areas of ore removal right from the start of mining based on the specific hydrogeological conditions of any given mine site. In its January 5th, 2017 letter to the committee, the Board of Environmental Protection specifically asked the committee that the committee consider changing provisions in Maine laws regarding groundwater contamination, floodplains, and public lands. LD 820, I believe, is consistent with that request. LD 820 also bans mining in, on, or under great ponds, rivers, streams, brooks, coastal waters, and wetlands. Importantly, this language is very similar to language in Section 20B3 of the initial draft of DEP's proposed 2017 rules, which states, and I quote, removal of ore in or under great ponds, rivers, brooks, and streams, and coastal wetlands as defined in 38 MRSA Section 480B is prohibited, except that gold panning, et cetera. Unfortunately, and for reasons that I do not know, DEP removed this language from the proposed rules at the request of one of the BEP members. Maine's water bodies and clean water are the veins and lifeblood of Maine. As we all know, they bring billions of dollars into Maine and provide employment for tens of thousands of people. There is no way any mining in Maine will compete with this as an economic resource, and therefore, the legislature must ensure that mining does not harm our water bodies, clean drinking water, and the many job-creating industries that depend on them. LD 820 would also ensure that mining companies pay for any accidents or spills they may cause by requiring sufficient financial assurance upfront, and the upfront is very important to pay for them. Mining is a dangerous industry, and disasters happen frequently. Companies themselves, not our taxpayers, should be on the hook for cleanup actions in response to any spill or accident, no matter what the cost. Representative Chapman and others have already spoken about the Callahan mine. We cannot allow a poorly designed, poorly closed mine like that to occur again. I've personally seen the results of poorly regulated mining in West Virginia on a march that I took a few years ago. Although the primary industry there is coal mining rather than metallic mining, the chemistry of acid mine drainage is the same, whether a company is mining for coal or copper. The pollution that poorly regulated mining has caused West Virginia is staggering, and we cannot allow that to happen in Maine. There are several potential amendments that I think could be offered and would make LD 820 even stronger. For example, I understand that many Maine people have opposed the provisions in the 2017 rules that allow wet mine waste management and wet mine waste units. In addition, many people would like rules that ban open pit mining, which generates about 10 times more waste than underground mining on average. I would certainly be open to amending LD 820 to ban wet mine waste management and open pit mining if the committee would prefer to address those issues in statute rather than through changes in the proposed rules that LD 395 addresses. Thank you for this opportunity to present to the committee, and I will be happy to answer any questions. I surely will be here for as many work sessions as I'm able to, and if I can wangle an invitation to the Callahan Mine, Senator Saviello with the committee, I'd welcome that opportunity.
By lunch, you get to go.
I'll bring PB&J. How's that? Thank you very much.
Senator Saviello, Representative Tucker, distinguished members of the Environment and Natural Resources Committee. My name is Robert Foley, and I proudly represent the good people of House District 7, which is most of the town of Wells. I'm here today to share with you some of my thoughts and insights on the mining bills and rules that you will be considering today. As a co-sponsor of Senator Carson's bill, LD 820, I believe his bill addresses some of the issues not addressed in the rules submitted by the Department and the Board of Environmental Protection. You have many other variations and options before you today. I simply want to add my collective thoughts, and you can decide whether they help or not as you deliberate these choices. By profession, I am a licensed insurance agent with over 38 years of insurance claims and risk management experience. I hold the professional designation of certified insurance counselor. For those new to the committee, in my life prior to becoming a legislator, I served on the Board of Environmental Protection and was its chairman during the first go-round of the mining rules. During that process, I had the opportunity to fully participate for over 3 months of very serious deliberations, having read over 1,000 pages of documentation and testimony and over 10 hours of public hearings. I came to understand the difficulties and complexities that these rules attempt to address. I truly appreciate the latest work done by the department and the current board. These are complex matters, as you no doubt are aware. I do want to say how important I believe it is for the department and the Board of Environmental Protection that we provide clearer guidance that allow them to implement rules for the statute passed by the 125th. It is difficult for them to accomplish their mission without proper rules that are supportive of the statutes we enact. I hope that today is the beginning of providing that clarity. In the 127th, I had the pleasure of testifying and working with this committee in attempting to make changes that would support the implementation of the metallic mineral mining statute that had previously been rejected in the 126th. While I believe that work was productive, I felt in the end that we hadn't achieved the balance and assurances necessary to safely move forward. I think the department and the board have once again attempted to meet our challenge in coming up with a new version of the rules to address those concerns raised during last session's deliberations. Once again, however, I don't believe the legislature provided the necessary guidance. During our discussions with the 127th, I spent some time researching and evaluating for the committee the insurance and assurance portions of the financial requirements sections of the rules. I believe that some of those provisions we discussed back then have been placed within the current proposed rules and LD 820 as additional requirements for added protections. In evaluating the insurance risk management issues surrounding mining, I came away with a clearer understanding regarding those risk options. One issue that I would like to suggest to the committee based on my research on the risk analysis of mining is the elimination of large-scale open pit metallic mineral mining in the state of Maine. It is clear throughout the world that in wet climates such as we experience here in Maine, large-scale open pit mining operations provides an even greater risk of environmental contamination. New technologies and methods of tunnel or shaft mining are providing better and somewhat safer environmentally metallic mineral mining operations. While no method of mining is without risk, I believe that we can diminish some of the environmental risks that the applicant in the state could encounter by eliminating large-scale open pit mining for metallic minerals. These would be sites where the excavation of mining area exceeds 5 acres or more, and the mineral deposits are deeper than 2,500 feet. In these cases, tunnel or shaft mining would provide a safer risk environmentally. These are but my suggestions. You can evaluate other higher or lower criteria. I simply believe that banning large-scale operations is best for Maine. I will acknowledge that shaft mining does come at a higher cost to the applicant, with some greater risk to the workers. Those are issues that the applicant would have to address. Our concerns here are for the environment that these operations would take place in, and as such, I believe that large-scale open pit mining should not be allowed in Maine. If in the process we are unable to find common ground and clear direction in the Metallic Mineral Mining Act, then we, the legislature, should overturn the current statute and eliminate the difficult task of enforcement the department and the board faces without adequate set of rules to follow. I thank you for the opportunity to address this committee. You have important work ahead of you. I'd be happy to participate in the work session when you have it.
Questions to Representative Foley, and thank you for taking a shot at defining it.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for coming.
Good morning, Senator Saviello, Representative Tucker, and honorable members of the Environmental and Natural Resource Committee. I am Representative Don Moran from Hollis, and I represent all of Hollis, most of Buxton, and a small section of the city of Saco. I'm here today as a co-sponsor of LD 820, and to also provide you with testimony and materials that I hope will help the committee to make the right decision for the future of mining in Maine. What this committee does with this bill and others that are before you today will set the stage for the future. I provided you with a couple of articles that relate to mining in the Northwest Territories of Canada and hope they may be helpful in your work. I know you have a full schedule today and appreciate the work before you and wish you luck as you deliberate on these very sensitive and complex bills. But I'd like to take just a few moments, if I may, and relate to you the experience that I had last summer when I drove to the Northwest Territories of Canada up into Yellowknife. In 2011, when I finally retired from working, my wife and I just started traveling the U.S. and Canada, visiting national parks. We've accomplished 49 of the contiguous states. We've done all the parts of Canada and all the territories. The only one that we hadn't done as of last summer was the Northwest Territories. So we drove 4,405 miles in a motorhome from our farm to the Northwest Territories because I was interested to see what the issues were up there with diamond mining and gold mining. Gold mining, which was shut down a few years ago because of the terrible pollution that they were having from the arsenic. The Northwest Territory of Canada sits on Great Slave Lake. It's the second largest lake in the Northwest Territory and is the deepest lake in North America and the 10th largest lake in the world, 10,500 square miles. It has a population of about 25,000 people. It's very modern. It has most of the amenities you'd find in a small city. Most of the franchised operations are there. Their legislative chambers are there. And most of the tourism that comes to the city flies in because the road is so desolate and so far that they fly in. When we drove in, the last 400 miles, we never saw a house. All we saw was three herds of buffalo. And we saw some First Nations people harvesting mushrooms. When we started to tour the city, we went down into the old part of the city. We drove around to the provincial parks. In fact, we stayed in one of their provincial parks, which are absolutely extraordinary. They're far superior to our state parks. They're very well manned, they're very modern. They don't have all the amenities, but most of them. But what I found out was that the city of Yellowknife is sitting on enough arsenic to kill every human on Earth. 237,000 ton of arsenic is sitting underground in a cavern. This has been going on since the early 40s and was abandoned in 2004. The mining company picked up and left town, left the local government, the Northwest Territory government, in Ottawa, the folks in Ottawa, with this 237,000 tons of arsenic underground. They thought it was safe until they realized that climate change was affecting the permafrost. Now, because the permafrost is leaving the ground, they're afraid of pollution of all these beautiful lakes that are around the Northwest Territory, including Great Slave Lake. It's gonna cost them $1 billion to get this under control. And then it's going to cost them $2 million a year to maintain it after that. And what they're doing is that they're putting pipes in the ground to freeze it like you would an ice skating rink to keep the thing contained. Rather than cleaning it up and making it less harmful, which they say is way too expensive, I can't imagine it could cost much more than $1 billion, but that's what they're doing. So it all came to light when a young boy from the First Nations tribe died of arsenic poisoning from eating the snow around the area. This mine was generating 22,000 pounds of arsenic dust a day until the government stepped in, and then they reduced it down to around 6,000-7,000 pounds. It's in the article that I provided to you. We probably would never have that magnitude of exposure, but it's important for you and important for the people of Maine that we take a look about what we're going to do about our mining. That's why I'm supporting LD 820. It probably is not a perfect bill, but it is a start, and I hope you will take it under advisement. And just one other thing while I'm here, while on this trip, we drove another 1,000 miles out of our way up into the northwest part of the province of Alberta to look at the tar sands oil mining thing. That is the most unbelievable thing I ever saw in my life. If I hadn't gone there and actually physically seen it, I would have thought it was just this bad reporting or environmentalist on the nice side of an issue that they didn't like. But that, folks, that tar sands mining is absolutely and positively raping the earth. There are thousands of acres of land that have been stripped. They're squeezing the oil out of the sand with steam. Then what water's left after that is put into these lagoons. The lagoons are as black as the oil that comes out of your car. And around all of these lagoons, and in the middle of the lagoons, there are flotation devices. And there are silhouettes of men with a raincoat on and a hat like a fisherman would wear out to sea. And he's holding something that looks like a gun, and it goes off every 90 seconds. I asked the First Nations people, what is this all about? Because I made an extra effort. I drove another 54 miles beyond Fort McMurray up into a place called Fort McKay, where the First Nations people have a reservation. They said that those guns went off every 90 seconds to keep waterfowl and animals away from the lagoons because it's so poisonous. It's pitiful. It's really pitiful. That would never happen here in the United States. It sure wouldn't happen in Maine. And I'm hoping that we step up to the plate and do the right thing to protect the state and our children. Thank you.
Yes, my name is Patty Blackstone, and I own Circle B Farms. I'm co-owner with my husband. Circle B Farms, located in Caribou, Maine. We grow apples and blueberries. This is why I'm dressed like an apple. I hope you enjoyed your breakfast today. I know I did. We are currently expanding. Our operations are starting to filter in throughout the state, and we're exploring markets in Boston. Good morning. I've never done this before, so good morning, Senator Thomas Sebelius and Ralph Tucker and the good people present here. I'm here in opposition of any bill that supports weakening mining laws, and I'll tell you why. Any bill weakening mining laws that permits foreign or domestic companies to establish open pit mining practices is absurd. Simple. It's bad for the environment, it's bad for agriculture, and bad for Maine. One sneeze or human error from the mining operation and a cocktail toxic carcinogenic slurry will be released into the Aroostook River and Fish Rivers. Open pit mines burp a lot during the mining process and after mining operations are finished. The Aroostook River alone flows through major settlements such as Caribou, and which we draw our water from for irrigation purposes, along with a lot of farmers. Unlike the mining, which is looking to be weakened, farmers are held to very high standards because you don't want to die from eating an apple, do you? I don't either. We are operating under the USDA's Food Security Modification Act, which requires that we test our water irrigation source regularly. If anything, any contaminant is found, we are shut down. My family, the Blackstones alone, holds 6,000 acres of land. The Aroostook River and the Fish Rivers flow through to the St. John River. And let me tell you something. You think phosphates are present in the Gulf of Maine because of farming, which the farming industry is trying to get under control? You're going to have metal. It's a matter of time. I'm sorry. I mean, you can put whatever practices in place, but they said the Titanic would never sink. Even God himself couldn't do it. We cannot predict nature. You cannot predict nature. Technology is fallible. I don't care what anybody says. So once this mining toxins are found in where the lobster industry is thriving and it's a $660 million operation, what do you think the lobstermen are going to say? I don't think they're going to be very happy about that. You think times are hard when the coffers are empty? You try. We've never had where our hoppers are empty. This strength, the strength of this country, is based on our ability to feed ourselves. You need to support your farmers if you want to continue that. I cannot stress that enough. This comes from a family, like I said. We have been farming for 14 generations, and I pray, depending on what you decide here, that we get to farm for 14 more generations. We also employ a lot of people, and our industry currently is a $210 million industry, and it's growing. The county has the capacity to feed the northeastern border of the United States. And plus, we have some of the best fishing industry off. Okay, I'm done. But anyway, I wish to ask you, we've done this before. This is the third time. It's like rape. No means no. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. I want to thank you for giving me the time to appear before you. And I present with me some guidance in the form of this still valid treaty, this law that I have here. But before I begin, I have to defer in honor and out of respect for my chiefs and ask that you allow them to take my place for a moment. Chief Commander is present, and Chief Peter Paul, and they are here in the room, and they're very busy leaders, and I'd like, if you would, let them speak so they can get on their way back north.
Very well.
Thank you. I present Chief Brenda Commander. Thank you.
Good morning, Senator Saviello, Representative Tucker, and distinguished members of the Environmental and Natural Resources Committee. My name is Brenda Commander. I am Chief of the Holton Band of Maliseet Indians. On behalf of my tribe, I am testifying in opposition to LD 395. As an elder and elected leader of my tribe, I am charged with the responsibility of protecting the health and welfare of our members and is sustaining and renewing our traditional ways and ancient cultural ties to the environment. As Indigenous people, it is our responsibility to respect and care for Mother Earth. We Maliseets traditionally fish, trap, hunt, and gather in and around the waters of the Wollastook, or as you would call it, the St. John River. We have done so for thousands of years. Water is sacred to us. Our spiritual connection to the Wollastook requires us to give back to the river when we harvest fish, take brown ash for basket making, or gather fiddlehead ferns from its banks to eat. All of these traditions we continue today. As part of this practice of giving back, we have been working for many years to bring sea-run salmon back to the upper St. John watershed. Historically, Atlantic salmon was and still is a very important traditional food source and an integral part of Maliseet culture. As I understand it, a proposal by J.D. Irving to mine at Bald Mountain in Aroostook County, Maine, is on the table right now. Our water resource specialist tells me that a previous study done by Boliden, a Swedish mining company, concluded that the Bald Mountain site has such high sulfur content that mining operations would not be possible without severe negative impacts to surface water quality. These weak mining rules do not adequately address the threat of acid mine drainage, which would destroy our efforts at salmon restoration and negatively impact the environment for our children and generations to come. I also want to highlight the lack of response to our repeated requests that state mining rules protect Wabanaki culture and heritage lands. Mining and mining exploration in Maine present substantial potential to destroy invaluable, even sacred, Wabanaki cultural resources. Our lands are limited and precious places where Wabanaki people can practice and sustain our cultural traditions for our children and future generations. We have asked all public notice provisions include tribal notification. Tribal consultation be required for tribal historic and archaeological resources that could be affected by mining activities. all tribal lands be included in the list of resources provided a buffer for mining activity, and tribes be eligible for intervener status, given the potential for significant impacts to resources of great importance to tribal cultural traditions and practices. I understand mining standards in the proposed rules provide a buffer between mining and lands which the state of Maine values. Yet, there is no such protection for our lands, which represent the last remnants of our homeland, where we can continue our hunter-gatherer traditions. Neither the Land Use Planning Commission, the Board of Environmental Protection, nor the Environment and Natural Resources Committee have addressed our concerns. It is deeply distressing to us that 5 years of our requests continue to be ignored. Education is key. I encourage you to gain a better understanding of why protecting the environment is critically important to the Maliseet people and all of the Wabanaki tribes. We invite you to visit our community to learn about us firsthand. And I wanted to bring up, I'm not sure if everyone is aware of or have read, the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People is guided by the purpose and principles of the Charter of the United Nations and faith in the fulfillment of the obligation assumed by states in accordance with the Charter. There are 46 articles in the United Nations Declaration. One most important, I thought, was recognizing the urgent need to respect and promote the inherent rights of Indigenous peoples, which derives from their political, economic, and social structures, and from their culture, spiritual traditions, histories, and philosophies, especially the right to their lands, territories, and their resources. We have raised many issues and concerns during the development and review of these mining rules. We will submit in writing our detailed comments from past public hearings that today still remain relevant. Willewin, thank you for this opportunity to submit testimony.
Do the committees have questions?
I'd like to now introduce Chief Peter Paul of the Mi'kmaq Nation.
Good morning. I don't have everything that Brenda did. To me, I just want to speak a little bit more from my heart. And, you know, it's really devastating what mining does to the communities. I was preparing for this last night, and my young boy came up and he says, "Daddy," he says, "what are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm preparing for to go testify against the mining." He said, "Well, what is mining?" I said, "The type of mining that they're going to do is they're going to strip all the topsoil off and everything that you see, and they're going to dig in the ground and take out some ore." And he says, "Well, then what?" I said, "Well, then they're going to try to put it back how they get it." And he says, "Well, that doesn't make any sense." He says, "I would rather look at the grass and the trees." I mean, that's such a simple concept. I mean, to take it all away, God does not come back and rebuild these mountains. I think we're here as leaders to help protect the future generations. It's something important, and it's something that I believe in. And I hope you guys really consider that.
Thank you very much. Questions? Thank you, Representative Bear. And what is the relevance of this frame?
Thank you for asking that question, Mr. Chairman.
Won't be the last time I hear about it.
My presentation is one page, and you've received an advanced copy of it. And I certainly appreciate the opportunity to have heard my chiefs and to be guided by their thoughts and wisdom, and I think they stated our position clearly. To elaborate just a moment, however, I just want to say that not only is this a threat to our environmental health and well-being, but I also refer you to the recent State of Maine Commission report published by Suffolk University Law. This is a study group that the state of Maine paid to have a study done of the Maine Indian Claims Settlement Act, its enactment, and what it means. What it means, especially as regards to the tribes and also to state rights that were crafted 35 years ago that have had the intent of settling a lawsuit by the Penobscot and Passamaquoddy Indians for lands that were transferred improperly by way of treaties with Massachusetts. And it was in violation of the Non-Intercourse Act. For those of you who know about this, this is not new. The lawsuit was based on the improper transfer by treaty of lands from tribes to Massachusetts, and later, of course, taken over by Maine when it became a state in 1820. This treaty is unique, and the relevance of this treaty, Mr. Chairman and everybody, is that this treaty is exactly what the Maine Indian Claims Settlement Act was dealing with, except that this treaty is different than the 1794, the 1818, and the 1820 treaties that transferred land, because this treaty with the Maliseet and the Mi'kmaq, their two chiefs being present here today, being very significant, is that this transfers no land at all. So the Settlement Act ratifies and declares this still the law, that for those treaties that transferred lands improperly, those have been corrected, those have been perfected. The treaties that didn't reserve land, well, those lands are still reserved. Now, when I talk about that, I say that we're talking about, if you look at my presentation, a map that I've provided you, Bald Mountain is smack dab in the middle of the lands that are still reserved to us. This is the issue. The Fish River watershed is one of five major watersheds that drain the north into the St. John River Valley, our tribal homeland. That's why we have standing, I suggest, to appear before you and urge a cooperative process on any plans to mine or, you know, whatever, whether it's gold. And I know people are talking about jobs and bringing in revenues, but we have to do it in a way where everyone who will be impacted is consulted and has a say. Nothing should go ahead without that say-so. And we have a legal basis to make such a claim. On Thursday of last week, you might have heard the explosion. It went off in the judiciary when that report was submitted, to the surprise of everyone. It was perhaps silent, but I felt it. And it's a game changer. The other thing you're going to be talking about this session that I'm going to be offering is to bring out those parts of Maine's Constitution have been remained unpublished. I've talked about it last session. Some of you senators and representatives, I recognize, having been here when we did bring it up. I want to follow through with making that public again to clear up misunderstandings that prevail and that can help guide us. This treaty is the law. In it, there's a way to resolve conflicts, and any outrageous behavior is between the communities, and we have to follow the law.
Thank you.
So that's my presentation, and I of course, therefore oppose, as my chiefs have spoken, the mining of any sort until what our chiefs have asked for is included. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? Thank you very much.
Good morning. My name's Kathy Sarek, and I'm a resident of and registered voter of Atkinson, Maine. LD 395 does not protect Maine and our most precious resource, water, and it should be repealed. LD 159, 160, 580, and 820 are insufficient corrections of the rules that are supposed to protect our most important natural resource. The only morally correct path for you to follow is to repeal the current flawed statute and put a moratorium on mining until an advisory panel of mining experts can present proposed laws that will protect us, our environment, and our natural resources. Maine is under threat by the mining corporations whose sole responsibility is to turn out profits for their shareholders. These mining corporations have no responsibility or concern for our health or that of our environment. That is your responsibility. Vote yes on LD 253 to repeal the current Maine Metallic Mineral Mining Act. Vote yes on LD 254, an act to implement a moratorium on the metallic mineral mining. And vote yes on LD 685, an act to establish a mineral mining advisory panel. As they are now written, vote no on LD 159 and LD 160, both of which only prohibit the issuance of a mining lease containing in total 1 million tons or more of metallic minerals. What about mining deposits less than 1 million tons? Most deposits in Maine are less than 1 million tons, so as far as I can see, this proposed legislation is meaningless. Vote no on LD 580 because the bill proposes to limit the allowance for groundwater contamination within the mining area. Contamination should not be limited, it should be prohibited. Vote no on LD 820 because you cannot make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. The language in LD 820 regarding the mining area does not include the land on which material from that mining is stored or deposited, on which beneficiating or treatment facilities are located, on which groundwater and surface water management treatment systems are located, or on which water reservoirs used in the mining operation are located. All of these can contribute to groundwater contamination. LD 820 states that discharges resulting in limited contamination of groundwater from activities permitted under this article may occur within a mining area. Limited? This is outrageous. Discharges resulting in contamination of groundwater should not be limited. They should be prohibited. And finally, LD 820 requires an applicant to provide special financial assurance coverage for worst-case catastrophic mining event failure. Has any mining company ever complied with financial assurance required in a worst-case scenario? At the Callahan Mine in Maine, where as of 2015, more than $200 million had been spent, and where as of January of this year, the US EPA on their website stated in its that, quote, contaminated groundwater status is not under control. This means that all information on known and reasonably expected groundwater contamination has been reviewed, and the migration of contaminated groundwater is not stabilized. Add that to the stated intent of the Trump administration to curtail the cleanup of Superfund sites. Is this what we want for Maine? I respectfully ask you to vote yes on LD 255, 253, 254, and 685, and establish a mining advisory panel of experts to come back to the public and the legislature with rules that make sense for us and our children. Thank you.
The room is full of organizations and individuals who take it upon themselves to self-educate and understand the complexities and hazards of modern metallic mineral mining. I think these people are heroic. It's hard work. Most of it is done without any compensation, only the hope that our combined efforts will protect the extraordinary and unique region called Maine's North Woods. More than 10 million acres of unorganized townships that make up the last possible region east of the Mississippi where we can protect the clean waters that we already have, the fish and wildlife, where we can continue to utilize the bounty of the forest, and we can set aside special areas as wilderness, where we can continue to grow the recreational economy, which brings so much direct benefit to the working people of Maine. All the great rivers of Maine rise in the North Woods. The largest of these rivers, the Penobscot, tumbles south to the Maine coast, providing water power, limitless recreational opportunities, and habitat for the growing numbers of sea-run fish that now, for the first time in a century, can move upriver and breed in the pristine pools of tributaries in the heart of Maine's North Woods. Imagine what that means for the 70 million people within a day's drive. Maine's North Woods offers the greatest remaining opportunity in the United States to preserve our traditional culture based on trees, clean waters, lakes, rivers, fish, and wildlife over a vast area comprising more than half of Maine. Metallic mineral mining will destroy that opportunity by allowing the mining industry the special privilege, which we fortunately do not have as individuals, of contaminating clean waters for thousands of years. The modern history of mining has shown the close to 100% likelihood of numerous slow-moving or catastrophic disasters. The growing magnitude of the cleanup of two relatively small Superfund mining sites in Maine, Callahan and Kerr American, shows us that prevention of pollution of groundwater is the only alternative. So my main point is Maine's Northwoods are a special place needing special protections. Our efforts should focus on defeating the weak rules of LD 395. LD 253, 254, and 685 are the fresh start needed to determine whether and how metallic mineral mining can occur in Maine. I would like to point also that I do not agree with Mr. Saviello that the views of Brownie Carson and presenting 820 are close to the views of representing the industry, which is what I believe Mr. Saviello does. I do not think there is any way that Brownie Carson can agree with what will be proposed by industry. Thank you.
Thank you very much.